advance this version.
All right,
you will. So for a little while, I'm going to treat you just the way I treat a university class when I first meet them. It'll be kind of an introduction to the kind of nonsense that goes on in university. I don't feel the least bit snobbish about high schools. I was a high school teacher and often wish that I'd stayed a high school teacher because I really enjoyed the relationship with the students. Whereas in university, until you get to third or fourth year, there's a tendency to be lectured to in very large halls by busy professors who really don't pay that all that much attention to you. I'm teaching a class at the moment at Laurier on the Second World War. I have 100 students registered, maybe 85 of them are coming to class, which is pretty good for a Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Even on a Friday, I can expect that. And they're an interested enough bunch, but you have to work very hard to engage them, which I'm sure is the case with you too. But I think that it's important for all of us to understand that what we do in university courses or high school courses in history and English, in what we'll call, in general, the humanities and social sciences, is the essential skills that we're trying to impart in the process are skills about critical thinking, clear writing, a clear ability to articulate ideas, and, if at all possible, research skills. Now, you guys are getting an opportunity to develop quite sophisticated research skills, and when you think about putting out a resume, even for summer employment, you talk about the skills that you acquire in high school and in university, rather than specific job experience, you talk about what it is that you've learned to be able to do. And all of those skills are of great importance in the world, and they have a lot to do with what we do in the humanities and social sciences. So coming to history, and coming specifically to what I want to talk about today, the background to Vimy Ridge and the background to 1917, what I always try and do is explain to students that as historians, and we're all historians in the room this morning, as historians we have a couple of obligations. One of the obligations is to find ourselves in a situation where we can, and this is a phrase from a famous British philosopher of knowledge, Archie Collingwood, we have to learn how to rethink the thoughts behind past actions. And what that means is to place ourselves in a context, in this case, the context of the summer, fall of 1916, and try and bring ourselves back into the world those people inhabited so we can understand their motivation and the reasons for the actions that they undertook. We may not be able to know them in depth in terms of personal psychology, but we can understand what they did and why they did it in the manner that they did during a period like 1916. So that's a first and foremost purpose. But grafted onto that is, and I'll try and illustrate this if you just go on to the next slide for a moment, I'll try and illustrate this for a few moments by talking about July 1st, 1916, the most infamous day in the history of the First World War for the British and Newfoundland people anyway, because as many of you may know, on the 1st of July 1916, the great offensive of that year, the Battle of the Somme began, and all across the front, those of you who've been to the Somme will know what I mean, the River Somme flows on an east-west axis through the center of this part of France, and to the north of it, hills are rolling, absolutely beautiful countryside with little isolated villages. As I'm sure you know, the French don't build farmhouses out on the farms. They live in villages and go out to the farms. So everything looks very empty unless you go into a brick village in the middle of a little valley. And the rolling green hills are very, very impressive. In 1916, they didn't look quite like that because the war had been going on in that area ever since the fall of 1914, and much of the landscape looked like a lunar landscape full of shell holes, and the water table had been disrupted, and everywhere you looked there were all kinds of problems in the actual battle area. And the British and French had decided that in July of 1916 they would begin a great offensive with a French army and British armies fighting side by side in the Somme Valley. Fortunately for the Canadians, the Canadian Corps, which by now consists of three divisions, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. 4th Division has not yet fully arrived as part of the Corps. We'll mention 4th Division in a few minutes. But fundamentally, the Canadians are up in the Vimy area. They're up in the north, out of the way of the Somme Offensive, which is further south in France. But in 1914, to be more specific, Newfoundland was a British colony, not a Canadian province, and Newfoundlanders were determined not to be incorporated within the Canadian Army. So when the Newfoundland people created what will become the Royal Newfoundland Regiment during the course of the First World War, they insisted on serving as part of the British Army, not as part of the Canadian Army. So it so happened that the Newfoundlanders were part of 29th British Division on the morning of the 1st of July, 1916. So it's a kind of interesting story because they are in a British division, in a British brigade, in a reserve position, and during the course of the morning of the 1st of July, 1916, when 22,000 British soldiers are killed in a single day, 22,000. And the total casualties for the day are almost 60,000, counting those who are wounded or who are shell-shocked, who are during the course of the day sick for whatever reasons. No day like that had ever occurred before in the history of the British Empire Commonwealth, nor has it occurred since. Almost unbelievable in the dimensions of what happened in that day. And it happened to the Royal Newfoundland Regiment or the Newfoundland Regiment on exactly the same scale. The general notion is that about 800 people went into battle on the morning of the 1st of July. About a third of them were killed, and the balance, except for roughly 180, were wounded during the course of that one day. Now, we can, as historians, go back into the mindset of July 1st, 1916, and attempt to understand what it was that the British commanders were attempting to undertake in the Battle of the Somme. And I guess to keep this simple, because I'll be coming back to this as I move forward towards the area that you're concerned with, 1917 and Vimy, as we think about it, we could say in the simplest possible terms that since Germany occupied most of Belgium, 90% of Belgium, all of northern France and its industrial zone, including the second largest city in northern France, Lille, that given the nature of the German success in the first two stages of the war, something has to be done. Don't know what, something has to be done. And the decision is made largely by the French commanders that a great battle in the Somme will either so destroy the German army in the defenses of the Somme Valley, or will attrit it, attrition being, I'm going to say this, terrible as it sounds, killing more of them than they kill of you, so that they wear out before you wear out, as the nature of a strategy in a battle. So the rationale behind July 1st, 1916 is hopefully to win a battle, and according to the British commander, General Haig, who has three cavalry divisions, mounted on horses with swords and lances and rifles in their scabbard, ready to charge through if any breakout occurs, if anything good occurs. Well, nothing good occurs. It is, by the end of the day, an absolute disaster. So we can examine that, but if you go to the next slide, we also, as historians, and you as historians who may go and visit these battlefields, are stuck with the question that increasingly what history is about is memory, rather than an analysis of the actual events that took place, in this case in 1916. Because after the war, the Newfoundland government, with the support, interestingly enough, of the Imperial Tobacco Company, was able to make an arrangement to acquire this memorial stretch of France in the Somme, the park at Beaumont-Hamel. And until 1949, when Newfoundland became part of Canada, this was Newfoundland's separate memorial park. And the Newfoundland government, having had, there are only 250,000 people in Newfoundland in the period we're talking about, and their losses on July 1st and their losses subsequently meant that many of the 18 to 30-year-old age group had been killed or wounded during the course of the war. So they took the process of memorialization really seriously, and it became more and more about how to remember what it is that we want to remember about the events of July 1st, 1916, which meant that increasingly nobody paid much attention to what had actually happened on July 1st, 1916, but rather ways of commemorating it. I'm sure some of you know that in Newfoundland, July the 1st, which for us is Canada Day, is Memorial Day. And people in Newfoundland go to church services or remembrance services in the morning, and then they try in the afternoon to switch from Memorial Day to Canada Day. At least those Newfoundlanders were willing to do that. And Memorial University in Newfoundland is named for July 1st, 1916. It's Memorial Day. And these caribous, the caribou is the symbol on the badge of the Royal Newfoundland Regiment, are, this is the large one at Home on Canal, and you can see that iron railing, you can walk up and view the battlefield from this very, very striking memorial. But the Newfoundland government also built five other caribous, one at Gallipoli, where the Newfoundland Regiment had been, and four others in France where they had fought. Quite remarkable story. So for Newfoundlanders, and after 1949, or especially after the late 1960s, when Beaumont-Amel became a Canadian heritage site, now managed by the Canadian government, and they built a really incredibly good interpretation center at Beaumont-Amel that tells the story of Newfoundland as it was in the early 20th century and what happened to it during the course of the war. So much of what people do and say about Beaumont-Amel now is related to memory as much as it is to investigation of past events. When you go to France, inevitably, if you're in the summer, you go to a place called Courcelette. Courcelette is a Canadian Corps battlefield. This very imaginary drawing is supposed to be the fighting around a place called the Sugar Factory on the road to this little village of Courcelette. So let me just talk for a moment about the situation in 1916. So the Canadians are safe away from the Battle of the Somme. Not very safe, because in the early part of 1916 they're fighting in a battle which is known as the Battle of the Saint-Alois Craters, which is one of the nastiest little encounters of the war. But by September of 1916, the Canadians are, if you will, at full strength. They have been reinforced. They are full of young, eager soldiers. And they are brought down from the north to join in the offensive in the Battle of the Somme. So Courcelette is September 15th, 1916. And on September 15, 1916, the Canadian 2nd Division, with the Canadian 3rd Division supporting it, advanced a very, very short distance. If you've been there, or if you go sometime, you stand looking at there's a little memorial to the tanks that were used for the first time in history on September 15th at Courcelette. There's a little monument to the tanks, and you look up the road, and I always tell groups, there's what's left of the sugar factory. It's now a nursery, but it's built on the same footprint of where it was. And then I point out, you can see the steeple, which is Courcelette. So it's an easy walk. It's a kilometer and a half away from what was the start line, as military people call it, on that day on the 15th of September 1916. So, again, being rather quick about this, just going to the Ancre for a moment. After the Canadians fight continuously between September 15th and early November, late October, early November, the conditions that are described here in this photograph, I use this photograph even though it's not a Canadian division, because it is one of the better ones I've seen of what is left of the terrain after all of the shelling and misery has been going on. Let's be clear, July, August, September, October. We're now in late October, early November. And the 4th Canadian Division, which has not yet been in combat, is brought down to join the Canadian Corps because of the losses and, if you will, the weariness of the soldiers who've been fighting since July. And the 4th Division, which fights in the Battle of the Ancre in late October, early November, becomes the 4th Canadian Division to become involved in this kind of heavy fighting. And if you're interested in military glory, if you big victories are what is really important about all of this, then 4th Division argues that it was the one that was able to secure the objective called the rest of what is called Regina Trench, a name which you'll see on war memorials in any of the towns that you might come from. The reality is that by the time the 4th Division was finished in battle in early November 1916, the Canadian Corps had lost 24,000 men. Now, I don't even know if one can comprehend that. In normal circumstances, about 25% of that 24,000 were killed in action. Many of whom are, of course, buried in cemeteries all up and down the Sun Valley, which is very much evident, and then there's many others who have no known grave and who are only commemorated on the Vimy Memorial. Their names are, if they were killed in the Sun, are commemorated on the Vimy Memorial, not at the men engaged in Vimy Salient. So we're dealing again with a situation where people have really worked very hard to think about what they want to do with this in constructing a modern memory. It's less important for Canadians, but for the British and French. For example, the Prime Minister of Great Britain maintained that every British school person was going to go to the Sun during the course of 2016. One of the things about a trip is the logistics of getting all those British school children to France are absolutely enormous. I've already counted this in a number of ways. And all of them are trying, if you will, to teach some lesson or to teach some useful memory about peace, about the nature of war, about how to turn away from violence as a solution, or who knows what, because it's not a very easy thing to deal with. Let's go on a little bit more quickly. The numbers are staggering. The numbers are absolutely staggering. This is just the period we're talking about in 1916, July 1st until the end of the war. And the proportion of killed and missing is between 22 and 30%, depending on which particular country. The Australians had a particularly difficult time. And the Australians are very, very conscious of their relationship with the Sun. There's a big Australian memorial, which is an Australian Vimy in the Sun. It was a reflection of the sacrifices the Australian divisions made. There's also a big South African memorial in the Sun, which again is an interesting example of this problem of whether we're talking about history and memory, because the memorial was built during the apartheid era by a white racist South African government attempting to commemorate and celebrate the contribution of white South Africans to the victory in Europe. And then after the collapse of apartheid and of that regime in South Africa, they had to, in effect, reconfigure the monument so that we could include the experience of black people during South Africa's war, which was, of course, very different, but it became a much different memorial as you recreated the past to serve what are present purposes. So the numbers are perhaps a bit overwhelming. What really matters in all of this total is that it's fairly evident that the battle produced the opposite result than the result that the people who planned the battle were seeking. Not only were they unable to achieve a breakthrough in which the cavalry could go roaring off and end the war, but they did not succeed at attrition either. Numbers suggest very clearly that Allied casualties of 623,907 exceeded German casualties, as one might expect since the Allies were constantly attacking. German casualties were considerably less than Allied casualties. Therefore, one is tempted to say that if anybody was attrited or weakened by the process of the battles of 1916, they were the British, the French, the Canadians, the Australians, the New Zealanders, etc., not the German army. The question before us now, and in a few moments you're going to have to participate, and I'll just stand here silently if I don't get feedback. I want you to just look at this map for a second. It's just a very simple graphic, but it's a graphic that's worth paying a little bit of attention to. By the end of 1916, in the aftermath of the Battle of the Somme, which of course came after the great German-French battle at Verdun, done in '70, which was equally attritional to both sides. Perhaps in the Battle of Verdun, the Germans may have lost slightly more than the French, but it's marginal. The situation in territorial terms is, this is Germany, and this is the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and these are Germany's allies, Ottoman Turkey down here in the bottom corner, and Bulgaria, Romania there. This is the extent of the black, or dark brown, is the extent of German expansion in Tsarist Russia, so that much of the Ukraine in the south and what we now call White Russia or Belorussia is occupied, as well as parts of Greater Russia itself. And then, of course, over here, just go on to the next slide and I'll close in on it. The Germans occupy all of Belgium except for a narrow little coastal strip, including Ypres, the town that all of us go and visit because of the men in gates and because of the other memorials that are there. And they control all of Belgium. This is the Belgian-German border. And all of these northern departments of France, including, as I said before, a big industrial city like Lille, a smaller but important industrial city like Cambrai or Bayonne, all of these places that would come to visit. Down here is Verdun, where the battle had occurred between February and the summer of 1916. And then, of course, up here is the sun. I'm getting disorganized mentally here. This is the sun here. Some battlefield in the area where that nice yellow star indicating that explosion is. The Australians in France, it's just this happened to be a map that came from there, and my research, my TA didn't take that out. What I'm trying to illustrate is the close-up of German control of northern France and of Belgium. So, on to the next slide, if we can. The question that I want to discuss with you is, was it possible to bring all of this death and destruction to an end in 1916? And the reason that I want to discuss it with you is, if you are going to begin studying as a project in a course, or you have studied in a project in a course, the soldiers who fought at Vimy Ridge, soldier biographies that you're undertaking, then it seems to me a fundamental importance to ask yourself the question, why did they die? Why did they fight on the battlefield, and why did so many of them die, and why were others wounded? We have a project on it, Wilfrid, Laurier, in which we are digitizing the pension records of every First World War soldier who received a pension. We thought originally, because that's what the secondary sources told us, that the numbers were manageable. But it turns out that we didn't know, and neither did apparently the people who had written the previous accounts, how many individuals were pensioned. And we're probably now dealing with in excess of 140,000 files, including mothers or wives or children, or people who came back from the war with a wound of some kind, or perhaps a loss of limb, who were pensioned through the 1920s. The files are incredible in terms of the detail that is available. We uncovered one that some of you will at least be able to relate to. Has anybody heard of Grey Owl? Did anyone know Grey Owl was? Sorry, maybe it's slipped away. Anyway, Grey Owl is a kind of fascinating figure in Canadian history in the period after the First World War, because he persuaded everyone that he was a First Nations, an Aboriginal person, who wrote novels and poetry and who created, if you like, the image of the noble savage. It turned out he was an Englishman named Archie Blaney, who had fought in the Canadian Army in the First World War, had come back with the Canadian Expeditionary Force, gone out to Saskatchewan, and turned himself into a native. And we have his file, so we actually have a whole bunch of correspondence from Archie, who's attempting to get a larger pension from the government, so he's not admitting that he was a soldier or anything like that in public, but that wouldn't fit in with the story. So there's all kinds of little stories like that that are coming out of the pension records. But what matters to us, sorry, I got lost there, come back to the point, is I think we need to understand what the hell we're doing in 1917. What the hell we're doing in the First World War, And we have to, in order to do that, go back into the mind, rethink the thoughts behind the actions of the young men of the four Canadian divisions in Copp at Vimy Ridge, and whose life experience we're trying to some degree uncover. So, let's go at this a little bit systematically, and then I want to ask you what to do. The first thing to say is, in the aftermath of Verdun, and in the aftermath of the Somme, even the most ardent warriors, those who most strongly supported military action, had to admit they didn't know what to do. No one had any idea of how to overcome the defenses on the battlefields. No one knew what to do about barbed wire, machine guns, artillery, mortars, and the ability of whichever side did not want to attack at that particular stage of the war to dig in. When the Canadians occupied part of the German first line in the Somme, they found that they had built dugouts 30 feet below the ground in the chalk soil of the Somme, and some of the dugouts that they had to dig people out of had their own furniture and kitchens and elaborate preparations, because from the perspective of the German army, they were determined to stay in occupation of France, and they weren't planning in 1916 or 1917 to attack further. It was up to the Allies to try and take them off French territory. So I think, number one, this is a fact, it's got nothing to do with interpretation. There is a very real sense of puzzlement about what to do next on the German side, on the Allied side, on everybody's side. And I'll say this in a phrase, there does not seem to be a military solution. We don't know what to do in terms of continuing to fight the war. So into this mood, a number of individuals begin to propose that we stop it, that somehow or other we construct peace. Now, the most famous example, of course, comes from Woodrow Wilson. Just remind ourselves that the Americans are neutral until 1917, that Woodrow Wilson himself, the President of the United States, is a, or shall we put this nicely, is a man of enormous prestige in his own country. He has just completed an election, 1916 is an election year, and Woodrow Wilson runs on, he is the man who kept us out of war, which is the slogan he addresses to the American people, and he wins a big victory in November of 1916, so he has four more years in office. And his first initiative, as he as in the aftermath of the November election, is to propose in a peace note that all of the belligerent powers end the fighting and come to terms with the reality of what is facing them in the world. The Pope, Benedict XV, has since the beginning of the war stayed, according to most people, neutral, and has urged both sides to stop the fighting, that are warning them that they are on the verge of destroying civilization, as anyone understands it. Perhaps most dramatically of all, the German government issues a peace note in 1916. Indeed, they have heard through their embassy in Washington that Wilson is going to take this initiative, and therefore they rush a peace note so that Germany is seen as offering peace before anybody else has publicly come forward. So we have a German peace note, chronologically, I suppose. The Pope comes first, Benedict comes first, the Germans come second, Woodrow Wilson comes third, as far as the public know, all proposing that the lessons of 1916 are that we have to do something. So, what I want you to do, just go ahead to the next slide for a second. What I want to do is ask you, and I want you to participate very quickly and in a very straightforward way. What do you want to do? What would people want you to do? What would you want to do as an individual? To the question of why we're fighting the war and what we should do in 1916 in response to Wilson's peace note. Who wants to go first? This isn't a question that requires historical expertise. It's a question that requires thinking about who you are, your view of the world, and your view of what little bit you've learned here. We have to do this all the time. Who's the bravest of the brave? What do you want to do in 1960? You tell me. You don't want, I know what, I shouldn't pick on you? Okay, all right. Who wants to be picked on? Yeah, thanks.
Can I push it again, please?
What do you want to do? President Woodrow Wilson says that we've got to end this. And I'm asking you, how do you justify not ending it, or how do you justify continuing it and preparing for 1917 and another set of offensive actions?
Well, I guess a justification for not ending the war would be a lot of territory, especially that was still under German control. Like, I know that France went into the First World War hoping to regain a lot of territory lost during the Franco-Prussian War. And I'm sure Russia wasn't just going to, well, yeah, sure, let's end this when huge amounts of their territory was still under occupation from the Germans. And so I guess if peace was possible, there would be a lot of negotiation, and neither France nor Russia nor Britain would be happy without at least the land that was, without at least the land back that was there before the war began, at very least.
So let me just push you a bit, and then I'll come over here because I saw a little flicker of thing. That's your position as well. That's very rational.
Yeah,
very
good answer. Yeah.
Anyone else? As I said, I'm going to stand here and make you talk. You tell me, what would you do in 1960? So, stand up so people can hear you for just a second. It's not a big deal.
I would choose peace, but there's a few didn't choose peace. Like, there were a lot of lives that were lost after 1916. So you could save all those people. You could return them home.
And what would you do about the problem your colleague, classmate, has raised?
Well, he said that there were, like, there would be a lot of negotiations. But, I mean, you could get through the negotiations. It would just, like, it would take time, but you could save a lot.
You're a good Wilsonian. It's not bad. It's not an insult. I need more input. Yeah, please.
Is this from my perspective with knowing how
both
this plays out? Okay, well.
I want to hear your analysis, that is, historian, and your personal perspective.
Well, see, knowing how history plays out, I probably would attempt to negotiate peace as some of the actions, particularly the Treaty of Versailles, ended up leading to the Second World War, which, if you could prevent that entire thing from happening, in theory, that would be millions and millions of lives saved. Now, I'm not saying they had any idea something like that would happen, evidently not, because I don't think they would have liked to cause it either. But from knowing my perspective of the whole hindsight is 2020 thing, I would probably attempt to negotiate peace, even if some land was potentially lost.
And personally? That putting yourself back into...
If I was in that position, honestly, I'm not sure what I'd do. I see both sides of the argument as valid at that point. If I had not known what the future would hold, I would see both sides as valid.
Well, in 1916, let me just stay with you for a moment. You at least know that if you continue fighting, the future holds war. And if you decide for peace, you know what? That
you know that lives will likely be saved.
And you know what the costs are.
Yeah, I kind of be stuck in a problem of neutrality position at that point.
You see, I think this is important stuff. I think it's important to understand not only the historical analysis, but where you situate yourself in this particular issue. Let me just add a little bit before I pick on somebody else. What is interesting about all of this is well before Wilson and well before the Pope, that started in 1915, and well before the German peace note, the British cabinet had been forced to discuss the issue by a very curious individual, Lord Lansdowne. Now, Lansdowne had come into Canadian history earlier because he was the Governor General of Canada during the Riel Rebellion in 1885. And he'd been Johnny MacDonald's counselor, if you will, during the question of the Northwest Rebellion. He'd gone home to Britain and he became the Foreign Secretary in the Conservative government of the early part of the 20th century. And Lansdowne was the architect of the Entente between Great Britain and France, which sort of laid the foundation for France and Britain to be allies instead of enemies, which they were in the 19th century. Lansdowne was also very curious because he was a very large Irish landowner and a Protestant and an opponent of the independence of Ireland. In many other ways, as a very wealthy aristocrat with a beautiful town home in London and estates in Ireland, a person maybe you wouldn't, or at least I wouldn't, I won't speak for you, feel very comfortable with. And for a very long time, people just dismissed Lansdowne because what he said before the cabinet, well before this, in October 1916, while the Battle of the Somme was still going on, he forced the British cabinet and its military advisors to say what they were doing and where they thought it was going, because he thought European civilization was being destroyed. Now, people who dismiss Lansdowne say what Lansdowne means is that my landed estates in Ireland and my townhouse and my servants and the luxury of my life is being threatened by the likelihood of the collapse of European society. We are, of course, be careful not to foresee the Russian Revolution, which does not occur in terms of a Bolshevik revolution until the fall of 1917, so we can't go too far forward. But Lansdowne's actual proposals are quite remarkable in the sense that he says, we have to have a very clear sense if we're going to continue this action indefinitely into the future, since nobody has any idea of how to bring it to an end. We have to have an idea of what we're going to be fighting for. Discussion is fascinating because many of the British politicians admit the reality that what they're really fighting for is, in diplomatic terms, something called the restoration of the balance of power in Europe. The British at this stage don't want a treaty at Versailles. They don't want to punish the Germans. They don't even believe that the French demand for the restoration of the lost provinces of Alsace-Lorraine ought to be a war aim. They simply believe that Germany has to be contained and prevented from being able to control all of Europe. And they believe, of course, in the preservation of British Empire Commonwealth. They insist upon the British Navy's dominance of the seas of the world. It's a very realistic discussion of what might be called limited war aims. So the British have actually thought it through and are maybe even in a theoretical position where it would be possible to go to an armistice negotiation, such as Wilson is proposing, and do something that might lead to an end to war. However, when you move across the channel to France, an independent socialist member of the French Parliament makes an appeal to the French Parliament in exactly the terms that Lansdowne made to the British cabinet. What are we doing? Why are we continuing this? What do we hope to achieve? What will be the cost? What will be the consequences? And the French Assembly and the French Prime Minister of the day not merely turned down any suggestion that peace is possible in 1916, but they turn on the independent member of Parliament and indeed any of his cool prayers and insist that France must be victorious. So one is placing oneself in a situation where all of these parts of France are occupied. The Germans, I hate to use the word German, I don't know what other word to use, but today I regard Mrs. Merkel and the German government as the most advanced liberal democratic government in the world. I'm a big admirer of Merkel and of the Germans. But the Germans of 1916-17 are, in fact, determined change the balance of power in Europe and establish themselves militarily as the major power in Europe. So we have to accept that that is the situation which we're actually in. It is equally clear that the Germans have real difficulties in imagining how they would retreat from what they have achieved in the first 2 years of the war. So we are in a situation where I want at least two more people to have the nerve to get up and argue the case. You see, let me push it this way. If what you could do is you could have an armistice negotiation yourselves. You could have people representing each company and sit down and work it out. What could you do in 1916? What could you offer in 1916 that would bring the building to a stop? Anyway. Can I ask you? No? Can I ask you? You've been paying attention, I've been watching you. What would you do? And into your personal values.
Well, as much as I am for peace and all that, just thinking, like, if Germany's so advanced and all that, they're taking over all this, who's going to stop them from doing it again? I mean, you let them go once, they're going to do it again, possibly. And history has shown.
That's the argument that was used by the opponents of Lansdowne in the Rich Cabinet, so you're dead on. They said if we, suppose we're able to get, keep this simple. The German position is a bit mystifying because it keeps evolving, particularly with regard to Belgium, which is why Britain had allegedly gone to war. In 1916, the Germans offered the Belgians to restore their post-war sovereignty so long as during the course of the war the German army can occupy the Belgian coast. And King of the Belgians is actually listens to that and thinks about it. But so much of Belgium has been destroyed and so many people have been killed, executed by the German army, that if the king and the prime minister of Belgium had cooperated in that deal, they probably would have been thrown out of office because the mood of the Belgian people is not at all the mood of compromise. They want to be like retribution or revenge or something of that sort. But that means, for example, the occupation of Belgium with serious levels of starvation, the only way the Belgians are being fed and the people of Northern France are being fed in this period is with American aid. That is, literally, the food supplies are coming from Canada and the United States, and they're going into Rotterdam, Amsterdam, and the Netherlands, which is neutral. Holland is neutral in the First World War, and then being shipped into Belgium and Northern France. Otherwise, there's nothing to eat in this sparse country because of the devastation that has occurred. So it is a proposition, and the point you made is a point exactly the kind of point that was made at the time. I'm going to come over here and ask one of you who wants to be. Just a value statement. Go ahead. You look less intimidated than she does. You're more intimidated. Go ahead. Just a few words. What would you have done? Just in one word, peace or war? Are you going to continue the war or are you going to, at whatever the cost, and you accept that? Good. Okay. Can I ask you? Just one word, peace or war? You don't? Peace, you guess. Okay. Anyone else have a thought that they want to share before we go into the council? In case you didn't hear that, she made a very clear statement that while peace is obviously what we hope for, it's evident that no one is willing to compromise, or that the situation is so difficult that finding a compromise is, well, that's, I just want to make sure that anyone who has a thought they want to share with us, how about some of the grade 12 students? I must have come from one back there.
In general, I would say you would have to fight. There would have to be war would have to continue because either side, Britain and France, would not let up any of their territory, and having Germany as another superpower would be unacceptable in the general mind of Europe. And having them have power again would be, volatile. They would look for more territory in the future, and they would want to be sort of a superpower of Europe, like Britain.
You know, you realize everybody who spoke was articulate and dead on in the sense that they reflected ideas as they existed in 1916, and it wasn't all that difficult. So, you know, you've got to have more confidence in yourself because you were able to think these things through as clearly as anybody else can. It's an issue. I just push you before I go on to the next slide. If you're sitting in Europe today, the problem with the new, if you will, international threat in Europe, which is Premier Putin's Russia, presents the West with a dilemma that is fairly straightforward and requires from all people who are citizens, as you're moving towards full citizenship, one of the difficulties is that probably the situation in the Ukraine, where Russia has imposed itself on the Ukraine by taking back Crimea, which had always been a Russian-speaking area that was assigned to the Ukraine during communist rule. So we can rationalize the Russian occupation of Ukraine. We can even, under some circumstances, rationalize the Russian activity in the Donbass Basin, where the war is taking place at the moment on the Ukrainian-Russian frontier, because both of those zones are ethnically Russian. The language in use is Russian, and the religion is Russian Orthodox, as distinct from Kiev and the rest of Ukraine. On the other hand, what are we, because we're a member of NATO, supposed to do if, in fact, there is a continued thrust of Russian expansionism with regard to those parts of Eastern Europe which were once part of the Soviet Union and once part of Tsarist Russia, meaning, for example, the Baltic states, Lithuania, Estonia, and Latvia, all of which are now independent states, as they were for a very short time between the First and Second World War, and now they're members of NATO. So what we've done so far is we've sent what are called rapid reaction forces, or in fact, all we've really done is created a base in each of those countries into which a rapid reaction force could fly. But I simply wanted to point it out because there are circumstances under which, however much of a person you are who believes deeply in peace and in the avoidance of violence and the avoidance of war, the challenge presented to you is quite remarkable. Would we, for example, if Russian soldiers crossed the border into the three Baltic states, which are struggling to become liberal democracies, would we say that despite the NATO treaty, war is no solution, and we'll have to have a diplomatic way out of a Russian occupation of the Baltic states? Because this is on your agenda in the next decade. It's not an easy question. And it wasn't an easy question for anyone in 1916. Not for an ordinary soldier, not for a general, not for a politician. No matter of means and means to put it. Well, the consequence is that nobody can figure out what to do. And therefore, 1917 dawns, and we are in a situation where we need to have, someone who believes in the possibility of a military solution. And this is an interesting story, but I better be very brief. The French army has been commanded by General Joseph Papadjoff, who has shown, I think it's fair to say, no particular intelligence with regard to the conduct of operations on the battlefield. And we are in a situation, you have to be careful if you're a historian about chronology, but the French army is worn out. And in the course of a few months, we'll begin to mutiny, and we'll begin to break down, and we'll begin to demonstrate that it is not willing to continue the kind of warfare that had taken place at the Somme and had taken place at Verdun. Don't really know that yet. The French do. The French are really worried about the state of their army and the state of the morale of their population. But, so anyway, they fire Joffre. and they appoint a guy named Robert Nivelle. And Nivelle is an interesting individual. I'm tempted to say that one of the key things about Nivelle is he was tall, dark, handsome, and charming, and bilingual. One of the things about the First World War is the British and French, just like it is today in Canada, nobody speaks the other person's language. So it's extremely difficult to communicate clearly. There's only a few British officers who, even though they've studied French, are not able to have a conversation in French. Almost none of them can speak English internationally. French is the language of diplomacy, not English, in 1916. And so, in a sense, Robert Nivelle comes to the fore not having had a great military career, but having an overwhelming self-confidence and an ability to articulate his ideas clearly to both the British Prime Minister, being King George, and the succession of French Prime Ministers. At any rate, Nivelle says he knows how to win the war on the battlefield. We can solve the problem. In the last stages of the battle, they're done. Nivelle claims he had retaken, as an army commander, French fortifications were done by very careful use of artillery, very heavy planning, training soldiers down to the ground level, etc. So, in a sense, there is agreement that what we will do in 1917, as soon as possible, remember, winter comes to Europe as it comes to Canada, so all of the great offensives have to occur in spring, or better still, in summer. But the Nivelle offensive, which is designed for the spring of 1917, is the offensive that we ourselves, focusing on Vimy, need to be aware of. Basically, what Nivelle sells the British and French government on is an attempt down here in what he calls an attack upon this salient, indicated by the dotted line, that a large French army with massive reserves in the north and another French army is in the south at what was called the Chemin des Dames will undertake a combined offensive that will break the German army, and the war will end in 1917. This is a fascinating story, very quick. The Germans respond to this situation by saying, we're not going to sit here and wait till this occurs. Instead, back through the winter of 1916-17, they busily constructed a new line. The new line runs all the way from Vimy Ridge, which the Germans will not surrender. They're determined to hold Vimy Ridge no matter what. So Vimy becomes the hinge because of its geographic physicality of a ridge-like structure. But the rest of the German defensive line, south down here, is drawn back 20, 30, 40 miles into what is called, by the Allies anyway, the Hindenburg Line, which is a new, carefully constructed defensive position. And in the course of the withdrawal, everything is destroyed. The Germans literally lay that section of France to waste, cut the trees down, destroy the houses, leave a wasteland in which when the French army re-enters in it, will find nothing to provide any kind of support. So, despite this, Nivelle still insists that he can carry out the offensive, which originally was designed to cut off that area that I indicated. He still insists that the French army can bring this about. But what he wants the British, and thus the Canadians, to do is to undertake an offensive in the north, in the Vimy, Arras, Long sector, up here where the blue arrows are, and he wants the Canadian offensive, British Canadian offensive, to begin before the French offensive to draw German reserves in the north. So that's what we're doing in April of 1917. We're taking part in what is called in British military history the Arras Offensive, in which 17 British divisions plus the four Canadian divisions at Vimy Ridge are going to undertake an offensive which is in the direction of, this is Vimy, and under ideal circumstances, of course, the offensive will continue towards the Belgian border, cutting off the German troops that are occupying the northern part of the sector. So it is important for Canadians to understand that the attack on Vimy Ridge is part of a very large British offensive, which is an introduction to a very significant French offensive that is to begin in 1917. Yeah, this is a close-up of the Arras offensive, a alone, which takes place in April 1917. And this is the city of Arras. This is Vimy Ridge, indicated by the hash marks up here. This is the Canadians under General Horn, the 1st British Army. But the offensive runs from south of Arras all the way to the area north of Vimy Ridge. And the great thing about Vimy, and again, it depends whether you want to be a historian and understand what happened on Vimy Ridge in April of 1917, or whether you want to talk about the memory of Vimy Ridge and what we do with it. Because what really happened is the Canadian Corps of all four divisions was asked to secure the ridge, which the Germans thought impenetrable. The Germans had been able to hold it in 1915, and they'd been able to hold it in 1916 against British and French attacks. If you've been to Vimy, or if you go to Vimy, you'll know that in the parking lot, where you park before you walk up to the memorial, there's a very large memorial to the Moroccan division. The French used a number of their North African colonies to create particularly effective militarily divisions. And it was the Moroccan division that made it all the way up onto the top of Vimy Ridge and held that sector until German counterattacks forced them back down to where the Canadians would start in 1917. So everybody recognized on both sides that Vimy is, in a sense, a special place. It's a ridge. It's been fortified ever since 1915. It has elaborate defenses. And nobody thinks for a moment this is going to be an easy task. On the other hand, it is also fair to say that if you are at Vimy Ridge and you stand where the memorial is and you look east towards Vimy and what is called the Douai Plain, you're immediately aware that if you capture Vimy Ridge, Vimy Ridge is an objective. It doesn't lead anywhere. You wouldn't capture Vimy Ridge and then drive from Vimy Ridge towards the Belgian border. There's no roads. There's a steep. The ridge is steep on the east side, very gradual on the west side. So Vimy is a specific, limited objective, which is assigned to the Canadian Corps. I have to tell you this, not because everybody in April 1917 believes the Canadians are the greatest army in the world, the most powerful or the most effective. In fact, they haven't done spectacularly in the war ever since the Battle of Second Ypres. They've done no better than anyone else at the Somme. They have no reputation that they will acquire later in the war. It's almost accidental that Horn's First Army is in position and the Canadians are assigned to Vimy Ridge. But, again, this is a question of the way you construct memory. What happened in April 1917 is the Canadians took Vimy Ridge rapidly, quickly, at relatively low cost. A terrible thing to say, 10,000 casualties in the course of a six-day battle. But 10,000 casualties in which at least something had been accomplished. And to make it more striking, the rest of the British offensive, or the Arras offensive, failed. It not only failed, it failed in many senses as badly as the battles in the Somme. Casualties were high. Nothing was accomplished in terms of improving the position of the armies. It's not at all clear that the British Army had learned any lessons from the Somme that allowed them to be more effective on the battlefield. None of that seems to have happened. The only good thing that happened in the Arras offensive was Vimy Ridge. And therefore, for the British newspapers, the American newspapers, first time the Americans paid attention to Canada, probably in all Canadian history, everybody said, my God, the Canadians have secured Vimy Ridge. So it became a victory that stood in for the failures that were taking place all across the rest of the front, because the Nivelle offensive collapsed badly. The Nivelle offensive tips the French army into the mutinies of early 1917, which make the French army increasingly ineffective. And to finish off very quickly, what we get as a consequence of this in all 1917 is the French army is in trouble. The First Russian Revolution occurs in March of 1917, the Second Russian Revolution in October, and Russia's taken over the war, which means that, for the most part, 1918 is about how close Germany came to winning the First World War before at the last moment it lost. So all of this is about how you think about the past and how you use the past in order to have some understanding of how we Canadians fit into the larger picture. We come out of Vimy Ridge, with a reputation as a particularly effective military force. We come out in our memory as people in English-speaking Canada, not French Canada, but people in English-speaking Canada say, the Canadian nation was born on the slopes of Vimy Ridge, because it becomes the great achievement that Canadians can identify with as something positive that comes out of a war that is, to put it mildly, not a very negative, not full of positive things. I don't remember how much I remember. That's just a close-up of the attack on Vimy Ridge. I don't know if this is any value to you, but obviously I'll leave it with you. You can see the Canadian divisions lined up. This, by the way, is the 51st Highland Division, the 1st British Division, so it's right on our flank, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and these are the brigades, pardon me, this is 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th Canadian Division, and the memorial is up in the 4th Division section. Sorry, that was a bit longer than I thought it should have gone. But you're very good. Come to my class at the University of Indiana. Thank you very much.
Do we have any questions?
I've worn them down enough. Seriously, any questions about that military side of it or social cultural side? You guys know what shell shock is and what its consequences are, what we now call post-traumatic stress disorder.
Maybe could you comment? I know you've done extensive research on the Second World War. Have you had a chance to look at this issue with the Canadian Corps at all in the first?
Yeah, I'll be very quick about this because it is an extremely controversial, interesting subject. In the First World War, we call a psychiatric or psychological breakdown in battle shell shock. Because initially, people believed that what was happening was that it was a concussion that actually physically affected the brain, and therefore it was a shock from a shell that created a situation where a soldier could no longer function. But there is, in all things to do with mental health, a kind of relationship between the person talking about symptoms, the doctor, if you will, and the individual, and they're not antagonistic, they're mutually reinforcing. So in the First World War, one of the major characters of shell shock is people, people want to exhibit the symptoms that are regarded by the medical profession as legitimate. They don't do that consciously. They do that in a culture in which legitimacy is achieved by behaving in a way, responding in a way that can work for you. This is what Freud called primary and secondary aid. I won't go there yet today. Basically, in the First World War, in order to convince doctors and yourself that you really had a psychological breakdown, people tended to have very extreme reactions. In particular, the word that was used was hysteria, because it related to kinds of symptoms that women had allegedly had in 19th century society, and now men were being demasculinized by war and were behaving in ways that previously had not been part of masculine behavior. So hysteria often meant a belief that you were blind when you weren't blind, or that you were paralyzed, or that you could not move, or that you, in other words, you exhibited symptoms that would get you out of battle if you had any serious shell shock. I say that because in the Second World War, symptoms were completely different. There's virtually no hysteria. Psychiatrists and medical doctors accepted that if you had what was called a startle reaction, or you cried when there was heavy noises, or you were trembling, that alone was a demonstration you should be brought out of the battle quickly, and that represented what in the Second World War we called battle exhaustion. Well, today, post-traumatic stress disorder, by the way in which the name works, means that the sense of being traumatized by the events on the battlefield occurs long after you're away from the battlefield. It isn't the same as combat stress reaction. It's something that you feel later as a consequence of the experiences you had on the battlefield. So we have a kind of relationship over the course of the 20th century in which I'm not doubting for a moment the reality of the difficulty the individual is suffering in the First World War, the Second World War, or today, but the way in which they manifest the trouble has changed dramatically in the society. And it's a problem for everyone to think through in the First World War. For the Canadians, there's virtually no significant shell shock until 1916. Send out a log, and then at the Somme, some battalions, 20% of their casualties were people who broke down under the stress of battle and who had to be evacuated to a rest station or maybe all the way to England in order to overcome the difficulties that they had experienced in battle. And then, of course, there's long-term consequences of it. I've often said in speaking about the Afghan war in Afghanistan that in 5 years, maybe it's already happened, certainly in 10 years, the legacy of Afghanistan will be post-traumatic stress disorder. That's all anyone will remember about Afghanistan. They won't remember the battles or the attempts to build schools or anything the rest of it. They'll just remember the consequences.
Sir. Well, and one last thing, Molly, if you come up, please.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Oh,